Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to the Great Big Friday Show here on Catholic Answers Live. Thanks for being with us. Lots and lots of people on vacation. I think the traffic has not been the same this week as it usually is. So maybe you are on vacation. I hope you are. Hope you're having a nice, relaxing time. Today, our topic, I think the effect of it is all in how you ask the question. Because the topic is, why aren't you Catholic? And we could ask that, like, why aren't you Catholic? You know, in a really annoyed way. Or we could do, like, why aren't you Catholic? Kind of a Captain Kirk way, you know, very dramatic. I'm not exactly sure how you meant it, so you'll have to tell us. Trent Horn is our guest. He's the author of a book called Why We're Catholic, Our Reasons for Faith, Hope, and Love. He's an apologist and a masterful debater, and also he lives here now, so he's in the studio with us. Hi, Trent.
Hello, Cy. I think that if Captain Kirk were to say it, you would put a period at the end of every word in the sentence. Oh, yeah. Why aren't you Catholic?
Yeah, that's Spock. How we should say it. Yeah, right. So, and lots of people, I don't know, I do not want to shock you, Trent. I don't want to say things that that upset you, but there's lots of people that aren't Catholic. I don't know if you were aware of that. As you go around the world.
I had heard about this, but it had not been confirmed to me. No, actually, that's something I'm well aware of course, within friends, family, and many people. And that's why I like to ask the question, why aren't you Catholic? I think that all of us, regardless of our beliefs, we have a few things in common. We want to be happy. Mm-hmm. We want the truth. And what's interesting, I had a conversation with a young man who identifies as an atheist a few days ago, and I tried to find whatever common ground we could to start the conversation. So I asked him kind of just a philosophy question. I asked him, would you rather live a happy lie or an uncomfortable truth? Mm-hmm. And he said, uncomfortable truth. I'm like, well, that's good. That takes us a step forward, because people who say happy lie, it's kind of hard for me to make any progress in the conversation, because you don't care about the truth. You'd rather just be happy. But some people are like that, but most people aren't. Most people want to figure out what the truth is. And even if it's uncomfortable, they don't want to live in ignorance, live in deception. So that's why I think it's helpful to talk about why people who are not Catholic are not Catholic. I'm sure they have a reason of some kind, and I'd be interested in hearing it, and we could have a nice conversation about that.
888-318-7884 is our number if you would like to engage in that conversation. Everyone's welcome to call with their reasons. There are many Protestant folks who might want to call and tell us why they are not Catholic. Some who are not Christian, maybe not even members of what we sometimes call the Judeo-Christian tradition. Everybody's welcome to answer that question, and we hope engage in a dialogue about it with Trent, 888-318-7884. We do think of the question as not trivial, because the Catholic Church makes a claim for itself that I think most religions don't. As a matter of fact, I don't know of another religion that does. God came down, took the form of a man, and founded this religion. Can you think of anybody else who's...
Apart from Christianity? No, I can't think of that. Most other religions would talk about how God gave a special revelation to a prophet,
yeah,
or a special revelation to someone. Not that God himself became the very revelation and instituted a church to gather believers together. And that's unique within Christianity. And of course, Catholicism would make the claim that the church that Jesus Christ established did not go out of existence. The church is not merely an invisible bond of brotherhood between believers, and that you can believe whatever you want as long as you call yourself Christian. And
right,
that there is a real structure to the church Jesus Christ established, and that church persists to this very day.
Again, 888-318-7884 is the number. But if that did happen, if God became man, and especially, I guess this sweetens the pot a little bit. If God became man and made clear to us that we have been created in love, we are sustained in love, we're called to live eternally in love with God, that's a pretty big deal. You might want to be a part of that.
Right. You might want to indeed be a part of the household of God that 1 Timothy 3:15 calls the pillar and foundation of truth, the church of the living God, the household of God.
And is it fair to say that I'm not sure exactly how to ask this, but it is the case that I can live my life without really seeking to know whether or not that is true. But if I do seek to know it, I will have divine assistance and even a divine promise that I will, if I seek, I will find.
Well, that's what Jesus says frequently, both in the Gospels and then also in later other parts of the New Testament, the idea that I stand at the door knocking, and whoever opens, I shall enter. That those who seek after Jesus, who seek after the church he founded, will find that God is ready to provide grace for him or her to be able to do that. And one thing we do at Catholic Answers, though, is sometimes there are obstacles for people coming to know Christ or coming to know his church, maybe questions, misconceptions, errors people have heard. And we like to try to clear that away by having, you know, honest conversations with people about what issues they're struggling with right now.
A whole bunch of folks already on the lines to talk with you. Trent, shall we go to a call?
Sure.
Again, 888-31-TRUTH is our number. Our question for today, why aren't you Catholic? How's that phrasing of it?
Sure. What? I think that's very hospitable to our
okay.
Callers.
Oh, that's what I was going for. Good. That's hospitable. not critical. We go to Crito, listening on the EWN live stream. Do I have that correct? Did I pronounce it correctly, Crito?
No, it's actually Crito.
Crito. Okay, Crito. Why aren't you Catholic?
Well, I'm speaking on behalf of my family because most of them are not Catholic yet. Or, I mean, they're not really believers of the Catholic faith, but they are Seventh-day Adventists. Mm. And I want to tell them why the Catholic Church is the fullness of Christ's church. How can I tell them, and why is it the fullness of Christ's church that he established on this wonderful earth?
Sure thing. And Crito, I love your name, by the way. That is also a name that's shared by one of Plato's dialogues involving Socrates. Very good dialogue about justice. You wouldn't happen to have any Greek ancestry, would you? I'm just curious.
No.
Well, it's still a good name nonetheless. So what's a good reason to be able to share with them? Well, first, I think we should, I think a good question to ask them would be, who founded your church? Did Jesus found a church? Did Jesus come and start a church? And when we read in the New Testament, we see that exactly was Jesus's goal, that Jesus didn't come to give us a Bible. In fact, prior to his ascension into heaven, he didn't write anything down. He didn't tell anyone to write anything down. But he did talk about the founding of the church. He told the apostles, "He who hears you hears me," how the church is built on the foundation of them, that in Matthew 16, Jesus specifically builds the church on the foundation of Peter, Simon, whose name is changed to Peter, that he tells him, "You are Peter, you are rock, and on this rock I will build my church." And I think one point you can bring up here is in Matthew 16:18, Jesus says, "The gates of hell will not prevail against it." So I think maybe you could ask your friends and family, where in the Bible does it say Jesus came and gave us the Bible? It doesn't say that. Did Jesus come to give us a church? Matthew 16, Matthew 18, Jesus talks about the church. He's coming to give us a church, the collection of believers under the authority of the apostles. So you could ask them, if Jesus promised the gates of hell would not prevail against the church, did that promise fail? Did the forces of evil prevail against the church Jesus started? And so we have to belong to the church that Ellen White started 1800 years later. That's Ellen White is the founder of Seventh-day Adventism. So I guess you could ask them, well, which church should we be a part of? The one Jesus started that hasn't fallen away, or one that somebody started 150 years ago, 100 years ago, in the past few centuries? I think that might be a good approach to bring up, say, who started the church? If the church Jesus started did not fall away, if Jesus kept his promise, which since he's God, he would, what church can trace its lineage all the way back to the apostles? And the best contender for that would be the Catholic Church. So that might be one approach I'd start with, by asking them, if we were supposed to belong to the church, which church? Who started it? Did Jesus start a church? and what happened to it. If you believe Jesus' promise and that the church did not fall away or die after he ascended into heaven, what church can go all the way back and have that historical connection? Seventh-day Adventism cannot. It's less than a few centuries old. So that might be one route that I would take. Is that a helpful start?
Yes, and actually I am one of the only family members that it has saw the fullness of the Catholic Church. Mm. And on this 2019 I will be baptized into the Catholic Church.
Oh, thank God.
Well, wonderful. I'm very heartened to hear that, and we'll be praying for your continued spiritual journey. A resource I'd recommend that if you stay on the line, I will happily send to you, that might be good for you to read and then pass on and maybe get a few copies for your friends and family, is my book, Why We're Catholic, Our Reasons for Faith, Hope, and Love. So stay on the line. We'll get you a copy of that book. And I think you'll be interested in chapters 10 and 11, which is Why We Aren't Bible-Only Christians. And then also chapter 11, which is why we belong to the Catholic Church, not Seventh-day Adventism, not Lutheranism, not any other church, why the Catholic Church in particular. So stay on the line and we'll get you that book.
Thanks, Credo. Thanks very much. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more asking you a question today. Why aren't you Catholic? Give us a call if you'd like to discuss that with us. 888-318-7884.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Debbie Giorgiani.
I'm a cradle Catholic, went to Catholic school, and I never really wandered from the faith. In fact, after having a taste of working in corporate America, I was literally pulled toward a more meaningful work. I began serving in ministry when I was just 21 years old, and I've never looked back since. I was not fulfilled working in a job where I couldn't talk about Jesus. I am most complete when the topic of conversation is God.
Take two with Jerry and Debbie, Monday through Saturday, noon Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Hi, this is Cy Kellett. Have you ever noticed that people only use the word spectacular in an ad? Well, we have a spectacular online event going on right now. It's our store-wide summer sale, which includes savings of 10 to 25% and more in some cases on every book, tract, CD, DVD, ebook, and MP3 we carry, including all the newest resources from my good friends Tim Staple, Jimmy Akin, Trent Horn, and Carlo Broussard. With lower prices and a great summer selection, it is by far the most spectacular online Catholic summer sale. So log on now and all this month to the shop at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our very special prices. You know it's all good stuff because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Why aren't you a Catholic? That's our question for you today. If you'd like to discuss it with us, we're always grateful when people are willing to call and discuss these things. Dialogue is so good for all of us. And we like hearing it on the radio, too. 888-318-7884, the number. Trent Horn, our guest both hours today, author of Hard Sayings, Persuasive Pro-Life, Answering Atheism, What the Saints Never Said, and Why We're Catholic, Our Reasons for Faith, Hope, and Love, in addition to the... Oh, God, Trent, help me out with the Ignatius Press one. I'm sorry. It's Friday.
The case that you
carry Catholicism around in or something.
A for effort. The case for Catholicism.
Oh, yeah, that one. Okay, right. A case for your Catholicism.
Answers to classic and contemporary Protestant objections.
Man, you write a lot of books. It's like a stack here of books.
I write a book when I realize that one of my furniture is like wobbly. So I write a book and then a year later I get it and I can slide it under there.
Well, that is a really, you must have a lot of wobbly furniture then. And some of this is, like, look at the size of hard sayings. That's like a leg is missing from that table.
Yeah, that was from a very troublesome coffee table. Otherwise, I have not found another efficient means of propping up my furniture.
If there's a better reason than that to write a book, that you need something to stick under the wobbly furniture, I have not heard it yet.
Neither have I.
Your motivations are as pure as can be. Let's go to Katie in Tennessee, listening on 99.3 FM. Katie, why aren't you a Catholic?
Hello.
Hi.
I need no further convincing theologically or spiritually. I'm convinced the Catholic Church is the home church.
Amen.
I live in Protestant land here in the southeast of the United States. Mm. And I didn't even know a Catholic until I was 21 or 22. Mm. So it is very scary for me, who I work at my church, I volunteer at my church, you know, to completely transplant my family into, I guess, a family that I don't.
Nope.
Katie?
Oh, they got her. Sorry.
Her
church came and got her.
Yeah, the Protestant land must have very good phone monitoring services.
Katie, call back.
We were cut off from you, Katie, unfortunately.
It's probably lightning or something.
I'm hoping if you do hear this, please call back, Katie. We will move you to the front of the line.
You'll be the first call we'll take.
You know what's funny, Si? Yeah. I sympathize with Katie because when I used to do pro-life mission work, we did a few events down in Alabama and Georgia, down in the Deep South. And we would stay with host families and stay with others. And some of the Protestant leaders in our group, they were familiar with us as Catholics. They said, you know, a lot of people around here have never met a Catholic, so they might be put off. And, you know, if you do the sign of the cross before your meal blessing. And they weren't telling us outright, but it made it seem like we shouldn't do those things so as not to, you know, freak people out. And I said, well, no, I'm not going to do that. I will still act as a Catholic, but I'll gladly explain what I'm doing. And people in these parts of the country, they were just amazed to be able to speak to a Catholic and say things like, I didn't know you all believed in Jesus.
Yeah, right.
And I was just so amazed by that. Like, wow, you have been told something totally off from what we believe. And so I give a lot of praise for Katie, and I hope she calls back and we'll bring her back to the front of the line.
So when you were there, did you make sure to worship statues? No.
Oh yeah. Well, I brought. I love the joke by Patrick Madrid and Carl Keating. I brought a giant statue of Mary with several children bowing down to her because we want the statues to worship the statues too.
There you go. Yeah. Fair enough. There are. I'll tell you what though. Like when you're in Alabama or Louisiana has lots of Catholics, maybe Georgia or I'm trying to think where else. You tend to get a very close-knit Catholic community because. Now I suppose there's a lot more people moving from the north to the south, but there's something about being in the minority, being a very slight minority that you know helps people learn each other's names.
You don't take it for granted that you're a part of the faith because there, whenever sacrifice is involved, you don't take things for granted. That's true for our faith and other things as well.
Dana in Garden Grove, California, you are up next. Dana, why aren't you a Catholic?
So I'm not a Catholic. I think that there's this fundamental flaw in all of Christianity. You could throw Islam and Judaism into this too, in that those religions are not based on God's creation. They're based on the study of ancient books. Trent does a lot of speaking. I'm kind of a fan of Trent Horn, actually. So
that makes one of us. Me too. Sorry. Go ahead, Dana.
Okay. Anyway, he does a lot of speaking about abortion. Frequently, he'll be talking about contraception, and he's using this term, nature's law. That's kind of undermining it. That is the laws of the way God has organized the universe to work, the way that life is brought into the world. That's not nature's law. That's how God designed it. And he makes good points when he does that, when he sticks to the design that God has. He comes up with these great points. But then we open up the ancient books and we get the interpretation of the teachings of the Catholic Church and we throw God's creation right out into the rubbish bin and ignore it, and we come up with all of the supernatural stories that are in the Bible that are like this blasphemy to God's creation of the universe and how life exists.
Dana, let me jump in here because I want to see what you're getting at. First, I usually don't use the term nature's law. I talk about natural law, which is something that is a part of God's eternal law. Natural law is just the natural order of the things that God has created, how they should function, how what their proper end is. So, you know, what is the proper end of a tree? What is the proper end of an animal? What is the proper end of a human being? What makes someone a good human being versus a bad human being, like in our moral behavior? So I believe that natural law, the way the world ought to be, ultimately comes from God's eternal law because he did create the world. So one way we can know God's will is through natural law. We can know by just reflecting on the nature of created things, hey, this is how it should be. And we look at human beings, this is how they should be based on their nature. But that doesn't mean we can know every important thing about the universe just from natural law alone. Sometimes God may want to just directly tell us what he wants us to know, and that would be divine revelation. And one way of divine revelation that's been given to us is God's word in sacred scripture. And it was given to us 2,000 years ago. That doesn't make it ancient, but just because something's ancient doesn't mean that it's wrong. So I guess, can you give me a specific example where something the Catholic Church believes from scripture contradicts what God has created? I'm not quite following you.
Yeah, I could probably give you 10, but let's just start out the ancient books of the Bible. They start with the words of a conjurer, presto, let there be light. And then just a few pages later, the creator of the universe, God himself, by chapter 6, is the fool of the story. So this is how one of the ways we know that these ancient books are false. The other ways that we know that these ancient books are false is you have the virgin birth of Jesus.
Well, wait, let's go back to that, because I'm not sure what you mean by this. The book of Genesis simply begins, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's not saying God's a magician or anything. I mean, he makes something from nothing. That's a display of his almighty power. And verse 3, God said, let there be light. Now, the Catholic Church just teaches that these first few chapters of Genesis are written in a symbolic way. We shouldn't necessarily read this as, oh, this is a newscaster or, reporting, or this is a transcript of what happened chronologically. And I talk about this in my books and in other resources, that Genesis is the way for the sacred author to communicate sacred truths about God, that God exists, God made the universe, God made human beings in a special way, told through the genre of epic poetry, which may use figurative language. So how is there a contradiction if I say, I look at the world, it appears to be designed by God, the Bible says God made the world? Where's the contradiction?
Why would the creator of the universe inspire man to write a book that makes a fool of him?
Where does the Bible make God a fool?
He creates the universe in chapters 1 and 2, and by chapter 6, he's so disgruntled with the violent nature of man that he has to use violence to kill all the men, except I guess for the 8 people on Noah's Ark. Mm-hmm. This happens right away. You also know there is no such thing in God's creation as a talking snake or a talking donkey, yet these things occur in the Bible.
Let me ask you a question. Dana, do you believe God exists?
Yes, the creator of the universe is the true God. The God that has been made up by the first century writers in these ancient books is just
Dana,
a blasphemy.
Let me ask you another few questions. Is God all-powerful? Can he do anything logically possible?
He's powerful enough to make the universe, and that's a lot of power.
So if God can make a universe, could he make a snake talk?
No, he didn't make snakes talk.
How do you know?
He knows this. It's objectively obvious to every person that ever lived that snakes do not talk, nor do donkeys talk.
Dana, I'm not asking do snakes talk or do donkeys talk. And for the record, I believe that the first chapters of Genesis it may record something literal, or it may be recording a figurative story using these symbolic elements like a talking serpent to describe the real historical fall of man. But even if this is a literal description of a talking serpent, here's my question. If God can make a whole universe, can he also, in theory, make a snake talk?
I'll answer your question, then I'd like to make a comment without you interrupting me with another question, which is one of your very clever tactics. Yes, God could make a snake talk, okay. But he didn't do that. And we know that he didn't do that because we have that experience. And then you yourself are so embarrassed by the story of this talking snake that you have to change it to the fall of man or original sin. Those words don't actually appear anywhere in the story at all. The story is about a talking snake that convinces a man and a woman to eat a piece of fruit.
And they're expelled from paradise.
And that is not the way that God designed things.
Okay, unfortunately,
we got to take a break. Dana, stories do have different levels. I'm sure you're familiar with that idea. They operate on many different levels. Trent will address that if he likes when we come back, but we got to go. We'll be right back after this with more Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live. The only thing missing from today's broadcast is you. Call now with your question.
Did you know that Catholic Answers Live is on TV? What began as a monthly series on EWTN in April of 2017 is now going to be coming to you on a weekly basis. You can catch Catholic Answers Live TV Saturdays at 5 p.m. Eastern Time on EWTN with an encore at 2:30 a.m. on Sundays. We'll also be available soon on Apple TV, Roku, and the Augustine Institute's multimedia platform, Form. Make a point of making Catholic Answers Live TV part of your weekly viewing, and we'll see you on the airwaves.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our on-fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Archbishop Charles Chaput of Philadelphia says of why we're Catholic, clear, practical, simply organized, very readable, and rich in content. It's a pleasure to recommend it. Bishop Thomas Olmsted of Phoenix says, "This book is made for the challenges of our times. I highly recommend it." Why We're Catholic is the groundbreaking resource by apologist Trent Horn. That one book you can hand to anyone as a starting point for helping them find their way into, or back to, the practice of the Catholic faith. Plant seeds of faith in the hearts and minds of your non-Catholic friends and family. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic today. You can order your copies of Why We're Catholic by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
I'm Tom Price.
And I'm Gloria Purvis. Monday, Monsignor Charles Pope.
And we'll talk sacred music with Adrienne Price. Join us Monday for Morning Glory, 7 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Summer is in full swing, and it's a Friday. And that means it's hot and time to have a little bit of fun. And while we talk about some serious issues, Trent Horn's here with us. Trent's apologist here at Catholic Answers, and he writes a book. Almost every time he sits down, he puts out a book. So that's not true, really. You sit down more than...
I sit down a bit more than writing books, probably more common activity, though I do sit down when I write books.
You are a prolific person, though. Like, you're a hard worker, Trent. People don't see this, but I see you. You know, you spend hours a day wandering aimlessly around the offices.
That's true.
And then you get to work.
That is the way I have to gather the thoughts first. I have to collect them. I'm a pacer. I am a pacer by nature.
Yeah.
And as for being hardworking, I believe I'm probably more of a smart worker than a hard worker. I just put a little mirror up by my office, and if I see someone's about to round the bend, quick, turn the laptop up. And,
that's okay.
So smarter, not harder. But I still manage to get those books written and to help people, and help people like our previous caller, Dana, who I enjoy talking to and be happy to speak to in a future episode. It's just... given the constraints of live radio, we can't have extended conversations.
He didn't stay either. He left the break.
Well, maybe he'll call back. But I do find it interesting, before we return to our other callers, because I think we have Katie on the line, and I really wanted to speak with her.
I'm glad to hear she's all right.
We will bring her on here in a minute. I find an interesting side that many people won't be Catholic or are not Christian. It seems like they have two views of the Bible. It's either this is a literal description of events, like the Bible is basically like some one person's diary about the past and God's dealings in the past, or it's complete fiction. Mm-hmm. That like people have no room in the middle for different genres.
It's very American.
It's just like it's fundamentalism. Either you are a biblical fundamentalist who says the text just says what it says, it means what it means, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Or you are a modernist, sometimes atheistic fundamentalist who says this whole thing is just fiction.
Yeah.
As in, well, wait, what about different genres? And I think Dana brought up the point, well, you're just inventing that it's symbolic to get out of the embarrassment. That's not true at all, because if this were literal and God made a snake talk, made Balaam's donkey talk,
with that.
I'm not embarrassed by that, because if God is all powerful, he can do anything. I don't see how the miracle of a talking animal is different than the miracle of raising somebody from the dead. It's easier to get an animal to talk than raise somebody from the dead. They had that show with a talking horse a few years ago, right?
Mr. Ed.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was a fine show, but he didn't actually talk. I don't want to shock you.
What?
There was some special effects used there.
I can't believe it.
It was the magic of television.
So that's what we have to look at. Say, no, there are different genres in Scripture still, that when we look in the text itself, there are clues based on the style, the tempo of the story, to see what the author is trying to speak about. And I talk about that in my book, Hard Sayings, A Catholic Approach to Answering Bible
Difficulties. We should have given that to Dana, but then Dana did leave quickly. But
if Dana calls back, I will get him Hard Sayings, and hopefully he will enjoy that.
Yeah. Katie in Tennessee called to say that she believes that the Catholic Church is the church that Christ founded. She herself is a Protestant in a very Protestant part of the country, and she's not so sure about how to come into the Catholic Church. Katie, what on earth happened?
I'm not sure.
Okay, fair enough, as long as you're all right. Your answer to why aren't you Catholic is, I want to be Catholic.
Just not quite sure
I don't know how to do it.
It's intimidating to be a good Protestant in our good Protestant world and go into something that I don't know much about, other than what I've read over the years and watched over the years and listened to you guys. So I wouldn't know how to take my family into something that I even feel a little unsure of myself.
Right.
Just in terms of the changes, raising a family a little bit differently and all of that. It seems like a big pill to swallow.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Now, Katie, is your family on board with this? Do they identify as Catholic, or is it more just this is what you're doing?
It's me. My children are small.
I see.
But it definitely would be a shock. I mean, Protestant churches are very evangelical, and, you know, the worship is very different. The services are very different. I mean, it would be a culture shock for sure. They'd probably be kicking and screaming, but again, I do think I'd be making the right choice.
Sure. Now, are you
in the long run?
Are you married, or?
I am.
How does your husband think about all this?
He is not what you would call a good Protestant. I think he would go with the flow, but
he's not that religious of a person.
Journey. Right, and I've been a Christian since I was, seven, or as we call born again. Right.
Yeah.
I don't feel from the Catholic community so much of an outreach. I think there's a lot of us that really love the Catholic Church, but we don't know how to get there.
I know.
We are exposed.
Do you know where your parish is, like a local parish near you, or no?
I do.
Okay.
Yeah, I would recommend, Katie, just first off, to go to the Catholic Church near you and just to inquire. You can speak with the priest and sit down with him and tell him how you're feeling. And if you wanted to come into the church and be received into the Catholic Church, the normal process, it's not always required, but the normal process is the rite of Christian initiation of adults, or what's called the RCIA program. Have you ever heard of that before?
I have. Mm-hmm. I have.
Yeah, so I would just go to your nearby parish and say, do you have an RCIA program, or could I speak with the priest about this? And what that would entail then is for you to be formed in what the church teaches, to understand what the Catholic Church teaches. And once you're properly disposed to receive the sacraments, if you are validly baptized in the Catholic, or sorry, validly baptized in a Protestant church, were you baptized?
I was.
Okay. Then probably you would not need to be baptized again, because we believe all Christian baptisms are valid, but you would receive the sacrament of confirmation and First Communion probably at the Easter Vigil. In fact, many RCIA programs usually start their formation period in the fall. And if you have trouble at the parish near you, if you feel like, oh, they're not working with you well, because, you know, don't confuse the church Jesus founded with the bureaucracy you can deal with at certain levels of it. As you know, in Protestantism, people can mess up the whole works. That's just in any church. I will make sure to send you, though, a copy of my book, Why We're Catholic, which when I was converting and was received into the church in high school, I wish I had had a book like this. So do stay on the line. We'll get you a copy of Why We're Catholic. And I think that'll just be good reading for you. Your husband, I think, would find it interesting as well, and fill in a lot of the gaps you might be having so you can understand what the church believes, so you can fully affirm that to come into the church. So go to the parish, ask about RCIA, talk to the priest if you have to. If this parish is giving you trouble, because look, remember this too. If you're trying to enter into the Church of Jesus Christ, the devil will throw anything he can at you to stop you, including ignorant and rude Catholics, one of his favorite weapons. So just don't let that intimidate you if you do come across that. I'll ask our listeners to pray for you on this continuing journey. So that, I think, would be helpful. And also, I'd like to give you this helpful bit of advice. So with your Protestant friends, your Protestant family and friends, tell them that by becoming Catholic, you don't have to stop being a good Protestant in the sense of the things that are very virtuous among Protestants and evangelicals. So, for example, Protestants know the Bible. Many of them know it backwards and forwards. Well, like when you go to Mass, you'll hear the Bible constantly. You go 3 years at daily Mass, you hear the majority of it. So to say, look, I can still understand the Bible deeply and thoroughly, be able to quote it. If we want to worship together as a community at the Catholic Church, I can go every day for Mass, every day to celebrate our Lord and the Eucharist he gave us. There's not many Protestant churches that have services every day. So I think many of them can see, especially if you see the biblical roots of our faith, then I think that can impress many of them and actually be a witness to them to say, hey, here's Katie. Katie knows the Bible. She loves the Lord, and she's Catholic. That's very interesting. So you may find interest more than animosity. So is that helpful?
It is. And can I give a 10-second word of encouragement to other Southeasterners maybe near me?
Absolutely. Go right ahead.
I started out of faith to say the rosary.
Yeah.
Every morning, and I was saying it online on YouTube with a group of people, and next thing you know, my tennis partners are Catholic. My Uber driver was Catholic. I mean, everybody I met in a museum or a grocery store was Catholic. It was like God started giving me Catholics in my life.
Oh, praise God for that. That is beautiful testimony. We're really big in the Uber and tennis areas, though. That's a big Catholic thing.
Well, good. Well, Katie, I hope this is helpful for you. Please stay on the line. We'll send you Why We're Catholic, and that'll help you. But yeah, go to your parish to inquire about RCIA. Have any problems, try the next one, or give us a call back. We'd be happy to give you a helping hand as well. So
thank you
for calling in.
And Katie, do you know that we do open forum here on Tuesdays and Thursdays? You can call with any question any Tuesday and Thursday you want.
Okay, great.
Because it would be great to just kind of hear how you're doing and keep in touch.
Oh, thanks so much.
Well, thank you very much. 888-31-TRUTH is our number. Why aren't you Catholic? It hadn't occurred to me, Trent. It had occurred to you, but not to me, that sometimes it's just a practical thing. I don't know how to become a Catholic.
It can be intimidating. Well, what am I supposed to do? Especially if you don't know people who are Catholic. It was easier for me because I had friends who I befriended in high school, went to a youth group with them, and was filled in. I had seen people become Catholic before I did. So it's not as jarring of an experience. But if you don't know, it's like, well, do I just go to the parish? Am I supposed to sign this form and then it's done?
Right.
What happens?
And do they even want me?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, don't let... And this is something we should work on in all our parishes, to understand that Catholicism, the Catholic Church, is not our little secret or our little thing that we go to and then hustle out of the parking lot as quickly as we can when we're done. That this is something we should share with others, I mean, if you see a movie you really like, you're never embarrassed to tell people you've got to go see this movie. You know, I was never embarrassed to tell people they should go see Infinity War, for example. I said, this is a really cool and interesting movie. So if you're not embarrassed to talk about your favorite movie, your favorite TV show, why would you be embarrassed to talk about the church Jesus gave us, the Eucharist he gave us? Don't be at all. Just share it with honest joy.
Right. I love My Little Pony, and I'm not ashamed. 888-318-7884 is the number. Why aren't you Catholic is our question. If you're on the line, hang on. We're going to get to you in just a minute. We just have to take this quick break, and then we'll do that right after this.
Catholic Answers Live with Trent Horn is coming right back.
Do you enjoy tedious lectures full of facts you'll never use? We didn't think so. That's why we're launching the Council of Trent, Trent Horn's engaging new podcast. Every week, you'll get lively lessons in Catholic teaching, as well as a new conversation roadmap that will help you share your Catholic faith with anyone, anytime, anywhere. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com now to find out how you can subscribe to this exciting new podcast.
Catholic Answers is doing it again. We're holding our fifth annual Apologetics Conference this September in beautiful San Diego, California, and we'd like to see you there.
We've had a wonderful time going home all enthused.
Every time we come here, it's just an incredible experience.
Normally, you'd have to root through a dozen different books to get half the stuff I've learned here.
These guys are so amazing. I always get so much, learn so much. I've already signed up for next year.
Join us this September 27th to the 30th for a lively and inspiring conference with an all-star lineup of speakers guaranteed to jumpstart your faith. All of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and special keynote speaker, Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke.
I enjoy the atmosphere and the friendliness of the people, and I'm having a great time.
I love it. I love it. I'm so glad I came here.
I've just learned so much. You know, I've been a Catholic all my life. It's just been so wonderful.
I love it. I want to come back every year.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
EWTN, communicating the faith.
And I wanted to tell you guys how great your show is because I listen to you guys for every day for the last past 5.5 months. It's because of you guys that I came to the Catholic faith. Now I'm going to church on Sunday for the first time because I just got out yesterday from jail. And I got my mom to go too. And my girlfriend is also going with me. Wow. She's willing to give the Catholic faith a try.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic. Call now with your question. 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Trent Horn is our guest for 2 hours today, enjoying a nice relaxed Friday where we want to hear from you about why aren't you Catholic. If you're not a Catholic and you'd like to share that with us, we would be very grateful. We enjoy the conversation and the dialogue. 888-318-7884 is the number. Would you take somebody who, well, I guess you would. I don't know. But there are many people who were Catholics, are no longer living or practicing their Catholic faith.
Sure, yeah, but what I mean by why aren't you Catholic would be why do you not belong to the Catholic Church or why do you no longer practice the Catholic faith? Because technically, someone who is a baptized Catholic who just hasn't been to Mass in a very long time is
still Catholic.
They're still Catholic, but they're not practicing their faith, and that's a question in its own right to be deserved. Well, why not?
888-31-TRUTH, if you'd like to talk with Trent. Trent also does a podcast. It's called The Council of Trent, but it's C-O-U-N-S-E-L, not Council, Council of Trent. How's it going over there?
It's great. We do at least one weekly podcast, if not more episodes per week. And I focus on very practical things for how to defend and explain the Catholic faith, how to understand it. We've had some great interviews recently with Archbishop Samples, for example, on the Catholic Answers River Cruise about sacred liturgy. Next week, I'm going to be launching another episode about how to share the faith on social media and to avoid the pitfalls of sharing your faith online and things like that. So I want them to be practical, how to explain difficult concepts, like in the most recent episode, talk a lot about the Eucharist and the Mass. And I really want that to be something practical, short, 20 minutes or so, listen on your commute, and things really build people up, and people can learn about it at TrentHornPodcast.com. If they become a subscriber to the podcast at TrentHornPodcast.com, they get access to open mailbag shows where you can submit questions to me, live Ask Me Anything video sessions with me. We just had one on pro-life, actually. You type your question, and I'll interact with you on a YouTube live feed. And if you subscribe at the silver medal and up, you get a T-shirt. So who doesn't like a T-shirt, right? Do you have? And he has it.
Does it look like this?
It does look like that. Our Facebook Live can see the Council of Trent with the logo that has a guy who looks like me or Shia LaBeouf, maybe. I'm not sure.
I think he looks way better than Shia LaBeouf. Okay, that's got to be you.
So yeah, so I think that might be... That might be helpful in that regard. TrenthornPodcast.com. 888-31-TRUTH,
our number. We go now to Emeka in Houston, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. Emeka, thank you so much. Why are you not a Catholic?
Well, thanks for taking my call. I will ask you, what's the big deal about becoming a Catholic? You know, that's why I just called, because I'm listening through your conversation with people. You know, you guys have been talking about the church Christ established, you know, Christ founded and everything. I mean, what difference does it make? And besides, many Catholics I've spoken with don't even know why they're Catholics. They only go to church. But if you speak with evangelicals, they know why they are Christians. You know, they're very eager to go and preach the gospel. The Pentecostal are very eager about the Holy Spirit.
Sure.
The Catholics can't even, and nobody, none of the Catholics that I've met has been able to make a good case for Catholic Church, or maybe defend. And then,
well, that's all about to change, though, Emeka. Let's hang on, because I want to give Trent a chance to respond. Mm-hmm. So why is it such a big deal, then, to be Catholic?
Sure, Emeka. Well, I would say the big deal is that God has a very specific plan for how he wanted to save the world and bring all people together in the new covenant so that we would all be one. In John 17, Jesus prayed to the Father that believers would be one just like he and the Father are one. But when you look in Christianity, all the different Christian churches, you don't see unity. People disagree about baptism, about whether you can lose your salvation. Are you saved by faith alone? What do you have to believe about all these different things? What about abortion, contraception, homosexuality? Lots of differences and diversity. You don't have that unity that Jesus talked about. So we would find that unity if Jesus established a church. Does that church still exist today? And in particular, what is the role of that church? Now, the reason that I'm Catholic is because God gave us a church, and through the church we have sacraments, that God can give us his grace, the grace that takes away sin and makes us adopted children of God. 2 Peter 1:4 says that we become partakers of the divine nature. God wants us to be adopted children. So when we're baptized, we enter into his new covenant family, and then we're fed and we're nourished with the Eucharist. There's lots of different reasons people can give for being Catholic, but one that just jumps out from my heart to share with you would be the Eucharist, that Jesus says in John chapter 6, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life within you. And we see from the very earliest Christians, they believed that the bread and wine at Mass, that the first Christians, they celebrated Mass, the same that Catholics do today, that they believed the bread and wine at Mass is not merely bread and wine, but it becomes the body and blood of Christ for us to receive, so that Jesus can fulfill his promise when he said we need to eat his flesh and drink his blood. So there's different ways that I might go at it. But one point I want to bring up with you, you said, well, Catholics, many of them don't seem motivated to defend and explain their faith. But I see these evangelicals, they're motivated, they're dedicated. But I caution you, motivation and dedication is not a foolproof sign that a faith is true. For example, many Muslims are motivated and dedicated to share and explain their faith. They're very dedicated. They love to debate people and share why they're Muslim. But of course, that doesn't mean Islam is true. So I think we should judge the merits of a church based on the evidence for it in Scripture and also in the history of the church. So that's one thing I would bring up, would be the Eucharist. One other point would be this. Emeka, what's your guide? Like, what do you use as a standard to determine if you are being a Christian God wants you to be or not?
Well, thanks for that question. I'm a Christian, and I believe that divine.
You believe what?
I believe in Christ.
Okay.
And I go to church, I listen to the word, I try to share the word. And then, like the Eucharist you talked about, we do the Lord's Supper, and everybody partakes, and we are already grafted in the, in Christ, and we just have to do what He told us to do in Matthew 28: go and make disciples of all nations.
Okay.
And it doesn't matter if you belong to a church or not, because all Christians. I mean, I don't see the difference, and no Catholic has been able to make a good case.
Here's where I wanted to go through this. The Eucharist might be something we have to bracket to discuss, though. I think you and I view the Eucharist very differently. But it seems like you say you spread the word, share the word. The Bible is your main authority.
Amica, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where does the Bible say it should be our main or highest authority, or even our only authority? Does the Bible say that's where our authority should lie?
Well, there are some things that are not contained in the Bible, like altar call and even the mode of baptism, how to administer baptism. Some things we have to apply our human, that's why God gave us brain.
So it sounds like you're saying that the Bible doesn't actually say that it's our highest or only source of authority when it comes to doctrine. So I guess, like with Jesus, what Jesus taught, did he teach people to follow? Did he talk about the Bible or the church?
Well, he talked about the church, and what I understand is that the church is a people. People set aside. So, I mean, we bringing in denominations, and we are, like Catholics claiming that they are the ones founded. I mean, it brings division.
Emeka, let me ask you a question. You say the church is the people. Do you mean all Christians are the church?
Yeah.
How do you know that that's the definition of what the church is?
Well, the church is a people set aside, for Christ, by Christ, just like, Paul was called, and his friend were called in Antioch, Christians, because they knew that they were different from the Jews. Mm-hmm. So they were preaching the gospel, the good news. And if you believe in your heart and follow Jesus Christ, keep the commandments, you are a Christian. You don't have to be, even if you're a Baptist or Catholic, or it doesn't make much difference. This is a human invention, and besides, I've spoken with a lot of you sound like a very smart man. I can tell you that. I mean, you sound better than a lot of Catholics that I've spoken with, mm-hmm. but nobody has been able to make a good case why I should.
Right, and what I'm trying to make the case here is that you see the Bible as an authority. But for me, I don't see where the Bible is saying all you have to do is follow Jesus or believe in Jesus. The Bible talks about authority first being given to the apostles and then to those that they raise up as bishops or as presbyters, as elders and overseers. That Jesus says in Matthew 16 that he has the church, but he talks about it being built not just on all Christians believing, all Christians who say, well, I believe in Jesus, but things about the Eucharist or baptism, things like that, well, you can disagree about that. He talks about it being built on the apostles and specifically on the apostle Peter. So Jesus says to him, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. That the very first Christians, they didn't have a Bible, so they weren't like modern evangelicals. They listened to the authority of the apostles. And so what I would ask is that if Jesus established a church, I think we both agree that Jesus came and he gave us a church. Does that church have hierarchical authority, like what the first church had with the apostles? Did that church continue, or did it just kind of gradually fade away so that there's no authority except Scripture, which Scripture itself never says that it's this particular kind of authority for people? So I would recommend that you could check out our website at Catholic.com, and also we have other resources, I think, that would help you to see that there are good evidences that the Catholic Church can trace its lineage, that the doctrines it teaches going all the way back to the first Christians, the people that we should be like, and that the Bible itself, the Bible came much later. The Bible came from the church, actually, not the church from the Bible, which is the other way around.
Amica, we'll have to leave it there. We are very grateful for the call. Thank you. Please call anytime. We do that open forum Tuesdays and Thursdays, and you're always welcome then as well. We're going to continue with our discussion, Why Aren't You Catholic? Folks who are on the line, please stay on the line because we're going to take just a few minutes break, and we'll be back with more Trent Horn on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and you've probably heard me explain Catholicism to non-Catholic callers on the radio or engage opponents in formal public debates. I've always hoped these interactions would show people how to graciously defend and share our faith, but they're not enough. That's why I've created a weekly podcast that will help Catholics answer the toughest objections against our faith. Every episode of the Council of Trent will provide listeners with a conversation roadmap that will help them share their faith with anyone. Keep in mind that I hate boring lectures. These podcasts will contain entertaining, informative, and practical explanations of the faith, as well as interviews with the best Catholic writers and speakers in the world today. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com today to find out how you can subscribe to my new podcast. That's TrentHornPodcast.com.
What difference does it make who or what you worship or what you believe? Sharing the faith used to make some people mad because it challenged their own strong beliefs. Today, it makes a lot of people yawn because they don't have strong beliefs about anything. Religious indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates modern culture. This is Matt Nelson, and in my new book, Just Whatever, I'll take down the building blocks of religious indifference one by one. We'll look at the different kinds of indifference you tend to encounter in your friends and family members to see where they come from and why they're seductive. What you believe matters. Find out why and what to do about it in my new book, Just Whatever. You can order your copy of Just Whatever by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers. I'm sure you have heard that it's still okay these days to hold to the quaint superstitions of Catholicism as long as you leave them in church. Because when it comes to reality, religion is just foolishness that withers in the fierce light of science. Problem is, this narrative is false. It is in the Christian West that scientific discovery has most flourished. Still, too many of us find ourselves flat-footed when confronted with bugbears like Adam and Eve versus evolution, creation versus Big Bang, and Galileo versus the Inquisition. What can you do? Come to Catholic Answers' 5th National Conference, Faith and Science. Guest speakers Father Terry Ehrman and Dr. Stacy Trasankos will join the whole Catholic Answers team to explain how faith and science are actually in harmony. September 27 to 30, right here in San Diego. And we are thrilled to announce a special keynote address by Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke honoring the 50th anniversary of Humanae Vitae. For all the details, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Archbishop Charles Chaput of Philadelphia says of Why We're Catholic, clear, practical, simply organized, very readable, and rich in content. It's a pleasure to recommend it. Bishop Thomas Olmsted of Phoenix says, this book is made for the challenges of our times. I highly recommend it. Why We're Catholic is the groundbreaking resource by apologist Trent Horn. That one book you can hand to anyone as a starting point for helping them find their way into, or back to, the practice of the Catholic faith. Plant seeds of faith in the hearts and minds of your non-Catholic friends and family. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic today. You can order your copies of Why We're Catholic by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Cy Kellett. Have you ever noticed that people only use the word spectacular in an ad? Well, we have a spectacular online event going on right now. It's our store-wide summer sale, which includes savings of 10 to 25% and more in some cases on every book, tract, CD, DVD, ebook, and MP3 we carry, including all the newest resources from my good friends Tim Staple, Jimmy Akin, Trent Horn, and Carlo Broussard. With lower prices and a great summer selection, it is by far the most spectacular online Catholic summer sale. So log on now and all this month to the shop at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our very special prices. You know it's all good stuff because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll-free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. So happy to have you with us. Thanks for being with us on this Friday afternoon or evening, depending on where you are. 888-31-TRUTH is our number, and we're asking you a question for this hour. Why aren't you Catholic? Why aren't you Catholic? Why? You must have a reason. Maybe you want to talk about it. We'd love to talk about it with you. Trent Horn is our guest this hour, as he was last hour. Trent, author of many things, including Why We're Catholic, Our Reasons for Faith, Hope, and Love. Hello again, Trent.
Hello, Cy.
How are you feeling after that first hour?
Good. A lot of wonderful exchanges and very hopeful exchanges with people who are interested in becoming Catholic. So those are people we should always encourage in our prayers and encourage them with a sense of community to help them walk through that path, not just to when they become Catholic, of course, but even the journey on after that. Because it's not uncommon for people to receive the sacraments, enter into the Catholic Church, and even a year or two later fall away and stop going to Mass. So that's why we need continual encouragement from people who, as Paul says in his letter to the Romans, people who were in Christ before me. He speaks about people who educated him, who were in Christ before him. Those who come into the church need that similar support from those who were in the church before them, even the whole time after their conversion process.
Something to take to heart. Yeah, because we can have a little bit of that. Sometimes it's possible to go to Mass, for example, and not really talk to anybody, not say hello, not...
And I'm not exactly sure why that is. I think part of it may be because of a tremendous blessing we have at Mass, which is that people go and see that the source and summit of our faith is the Eucharist, the body and blood of Jesus Christ. That is why, even if a homily is dreadful, even if the music is horrendous...
You've been to my parish? Just kidding.
I will not be held liable from anyone from Cy's parish who will come over you over that.
That's not true about my parish.
You still go to receive Jesus. And some people, though, the problem is that they confuse the highest purpose of going to Mass, to offer the sacrifice of the Mass, to receive Jesus in the Eucharist, as being the only purpose. I'm just going here, I'm getting Jesus, and then I'm out of here. That one can have a highest purpose, but also other purposes, such as building up the community and the body of Christ among one another, and to be able to invite others into that.
Yeah. All right, well, let's go to Colleen. Colleen, I don't know where you are, but I'm happy you're here. And why aren't you a Catholic?
Hi, I am calling from Cleveland, Ohio.
Oh.
And
sorry about LeBron.
I am. I just became Catholic a few years ago after I had a cardiac arrest. It was something I wanted to do all my life, and then when I had the cardiac arrest, I realized that, I mean, you just don't know when something like that's going to happen, and I didn't have time, you know.
Well, Colleen, we actually...
But I made sure I did it right away.
Right. We carry a book called Deathbed Confessions, and I am sincerely grateful that you are not a member of that book, so that it was a near-death kick in the pants, if you will, and so now you're on your way from that.
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, good. So how can we help you today?
Well, I'm Catholic, but none of my family, my immediate family is, or my children, because I didn't become Catholic until a few years ago. Mm-hmm. So they're older children, but they think that I'm just crazy for becoming Catholic. Now, some of them do believe in God, but some of them don't even believe in God. So,
Colleen, did your family, when your children were younger, did you go to church or have a religious background?
No, not my children.
Mm-hmm. Oh, even when they were littler. So your religious conversion happened later on?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you're wondering, now that you're Catholic, they kind of look at you bewildered. Some of them believe in God. What do you think are their big objections or their big issues they have with the church?
Most recently, one of the my brother, who does not believe in God, said that the majority of people in the world don't believe in God. And I just said I didn't think that was true, but I didn't really know either way. I was just trying to,
I am extremely doubtful of that. One, I am extremely doubtful of that claim. I would say that, at least within the United States, those who claim to be atheists, it's only a few percent of the population. The majority of the world professes belief in God of some kind, and the largest group would be those who profess belief in the God of Christianity, with Islam coming along close second there. But I would also, you said this was your son who said this?
No, my brother.
Your brother. Okay. So your brother said this. I'd also say the number two, what does it matter what the majority of the minority believes? Because let's say you found an atlas and you showed it to him, and it will probably say the majority of people in the world believe in God. That probably is not going to change his mind, nor should it. That our beliefs should not be based on, well, here's what everybody else believes, so I'm going to believe that. Our beliefs should be based on, hey, well, where does the evidence lie? Because I'm sure you could end up showing him that most people believe in God, but he's not going to change his mind, nor should he. Rather, he should look at evidence or reasons to believe in God. So are there any other hurdles you've come across with family on this question?
My mom, then, she says, how do you know that things weren't changed within the last 2,000 years? People could have done, you know, anything or written anything. And
changed like in the, you mean like in the Bible? You mean like in the Bible, Colleen?
Say, for instance.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there's actually a great field that studies the Bible. It's called textual criticism. So what textual critics do, because we do not have the original copies of the Bible. They were written on papyrus leaves. They were written on things that eventually decay centuries later. We don't have the original copies, the original autographs of the Bible, or even copies of those. But the thing is, because the Bible is the Word of God and it was cherished by Christians who took it to all the different churches in the ancient world, copies of it were made. More copies were made of this book than any other ancient book. So if people have confidence that when we read ancient Greek and Roman plays or stories or histories, have you ever heard the expression Nero fiddled when Rome burned?
No.
Okay, but you're probably familiar with the Emperor Nero, ancient Rome, the Great Fire of Rome. Mm-hmm. Those ring a bell?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sure. Well, the reason we know about those things is because we read about them in ancient Roman histories. But you see, there's not very many copies of those things. Like, there's this one ancient Roman historian, a guy named Tacitus. He wrote a big history of the ancient Roman world. That's the time when Jesus lived. You had Emperor Augustus and Nero and Claudius and these kinds of people. But his part of his history, an important part of it, it was written and destroyed. The oldest copy we have is one copy from the 11th century. Yet modern scholars don't say, oh, we have no idea what happened in the ancient Roman world. People could have changed this. We have no idea. They don't say that. They say, well, this is pretty good. So if we have better evidence for the Bible than we do for ancient non-Christian works, then we should have more confidence in the Bible. And guess what? We do have better evidence for the Bible because we have many more manuscripts, like that guy Tacitus I told you about. We have one copy of his histories from the 11th century. Guess how many copies of the Bible that we have from in the ancient world, you know, the time before the 10th century. Take a guess.
Well, of course, many, many more, since what you said. I don't know, from then, 20 maybe, 25?
There are 25,000 copies.
Oh, wow.
5,000 of those copies are in the ancient Greek language, and hundreds of copies can be dated within the first few centuries from the time of Jesus. So here's what's great, because if your relatives say, well, people could have, they might have changed everything, they might have changed a bunch of things. Well, yeah, you could change one copy over in this city, but guess what? If you've got 100 other copies in the ancient world, you can say, hey, wait a minute, that's not right. And so then you know that it's not right. You can compare the copies. Also, the religion of, this is what's great about Catholicism, our religion is not solely the Bible. Because for the first century, first few centuries, there was no accepted text of the Bible. There were sacred writings attributed to the apostles. But most people learned about the faith by having it preached to them in church, and then the Bible, and then later when there'd be letters from Paul and the Gospels, they would be read in churches, and people heard these stories, and they did not like them changed. In fact, there is a story, Augustine talks about this, or I think it's Augustine or Jerome in the 5th century, talk about how the story of Jonah and the whale was changed very, very slightly. One word was changed in a church in Africa, and the people they rioted in the streets over changing that one word in the story. People did not take kindly to the Bible being changed. So to summarize, because there's thousands of copies, you can check them against each other, and if one copy's in error, you've got tons more to see what the correct translation should be. So we have all kinds of tools to know that the Bible we have today is the same, is 99.99% the same as the Bible as it was written 2,000 years ago. And we have that tradition passed on to us outside of the Bible through the church fathers, the saints of the Catholic faith. So God has trusted us with his word and given us many ways to faithfully know it's been handed on to us. And I cover that a little bit in my book, Hard Sayings, A Catholic Approach to Bible Difficulties, in the appendix. But my book, Why We're Catholic, might also be a good start for you. So is that helpful?
Yes, very helpful. Yes, thank you so much.
No problem.
All right, Colleen, thank you very much for your call.
Thank you.
We got to take a break, Trent. Sorry.
No problem.
Fire up those jets. We'll be coming right back. We're going to go quick through these questions now because there's a lot of people want to talk to you today, and the time's a wasting. Well, not wasting. I mean, the time's evaporating. Let's say that.
The times, they are a-changing.
And we'll be right back. Thanks, thanks for that, Trent. We'll be right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Trent Horn. Are you looking for a dynamic Catholic speaker to present at your next conference or parish event? Well, we've got a whole host of speakers who are eager to share the truth of the Catholic faith in your community. Go to CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com to get all the information you need to make your event the talk of the town. That's CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com.
For a complete list of the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network AM and FM stations across America, go to EWTN.com. Look for the radio pull-down menu and select AM/FM stations. The list is updated regularly, so visit often. Again, go to EWTN.com. Look for the radio pull-down menu and select AM/FM stations. Also at EWTN.com, you'll find out how to listen to us on the web, on shortwave, and in some countries on satellite. You'll find it all on EWTN.com.
A skeptic once engaged me in conversation saying, "Yeah, I'm skeptical about everything." To which I replied, "Are you skeptical about that?" And I actually got a chuckle out of his girlfriend standing nearby. You see, the claim, "I doubt everything," refutes itself. If a skeptic doubts everything, well then he must doubt the claim, "I doubt everything." Which of course is the same as saying, "I doubt that I doubt everything." This is absurd. If a skeptic doubts his own assertion, "I doubt everything," well then why even put it forward? Suppose my skeptic friend retorted, "No, I'm certain I doubt everything." Well, this wouldn't help him either, because there would be one thing he doesn't doubt, namely the claim, "I doubt everything." No matter how a radical skeptic approaches his skepticism, whether he doubts it or affirms it, he ends in a self-contradiction. I'm Carlo Broussard with a ready reason for Catholic Answers. Catholic.com.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Having a lot of fun in the break here at the studio because Thomas, who is an intern from Thomas Aquinas College, you know where that is,
Not too far from here, yeah.
His family's here
them.
So we got Thomas and the whole family out there. And, you know, this is really cool. His mom, it's her birthday. And you know what she wanted to do on her birthday?
I don't know.
I believe it was meet me, right? No, it wasn't that. She wanted to come to Catholic Answers.
That's wonderful. And now we can actually sing happy birthday to her, and nobody can sue us because I think happy birthday is
in public domain.
It's in public domain, now.
Right? But I don't want to sing happy birthday.
But doesn't mean just because you can do it doesn't mean you have to do it.
We can have Thomas whistle it. Thomas, the intern, whistles beautifully. Yeah. I don't know if you ever heard that, but yeah.
I have not.
All right. Let's go to Bill in. Oh, well, I should probably let you know what our topic is today. Why aren't you Catholic? We're asking you the questions today. Why aren't you Catholic? And if you'd like to talk with us about why you are not within the church, give us a call, 888-318-7884. 888-31-TRUTH if you prefer the spelled version of it. We go now to Bill in West Virginia, listening on the radio. That's a good way to listen, Bill. Your question, or excuse me, not your question, why aren't you Catholic?
Well, I don't know anybody that is, but my question, I guess, was, I'm saved, don't get me wrong, but is Catholic, is it better than the other, you know, religions that's out here? You know,
you're talking about other denominations like Baptists or Presbyterians, things like that.
Right. Well, I mean, I guess my question is I don't personally know anybody that is Catholic. I've only been listening to you guys now for about 2 months.
Sure.
But I got to give kudos to you for everything that I've ever heard on your program has been, you know, you guys have been spot on with people calling in and asking questions. So for that, man, you guys is awesome.
Well, thank you, Bill.
Sure.
But for not being Catholic, is that saying that because I'm not, does that mean that I don't go to heaven?
Sure.
Is Catholic better than, you know, the other religions out here? Because, like I said, I don't know. That's why I was calling.
Fair enough, Bill.
Yeah, sure thing. Well, Bill, what the church teaches is that Jesus Christ, God became man, died for our sins, and he gave us a church. He gave us a church built on the foundation of the apostles, because if you look around at all the different churches, in West Virginia and in the whole country and the whole world, you know, people who say they're Protestant, they're Baptist, whatever, they don't often agree on a lot of things except the very bare minimum, like, well, we just believe in Jesus. You know, but what does that mean? You know, do I have to be baptized? Should I baptize my baby? Can I lose my salvation? Do I have to receive the Eucharist? Do I have to believe Jesus is in the Eucharist? What am I supposed to believe and do? What does all of that mean? But Jesus, what he wanted was unity among believers. He wanted to came in John 17. Jesus prayed that we believers would be one, just as he and the Father are one. And Paul's letter to the Ephesians in Ephesians 4:5 talks about how we have one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And the New Testament talks about not churches people start in order to praise Jesus, but the church. Like 1 Timothy 3:15 says that the church, the household of God, is the pillar and foundation of truth. That Jesus came to give us a church built on the apostles and their successors. And that church eventually gave us the Bible, the canon of Scripture, compiled all the ancient gospels and letters together so that we could know, hey, this is the Bible, that God's word has been given to the apostles. It's been taught here in the churches. We've read the sacred writings, and now it's come to us here in the Bible that's been put together. And so through this church, we receive things like the sacraments, like the Eucharist, and not just the Lord's Supper, but that we believe that because the priest His authority comes from the bishop, and the bishop was ordained by another bishop, and that there's a line of succession going back to the apostles, that Catholics have priests because a priest can offer the sacrifice of the Mass, can offer the body and blood of Christ to fulfill what Jesus said in John 6, which is that unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you won't have eternal life. So what I'm getting from you, what I'm hearing is, well, should I become Catholic because if I'm Protestant and I go to heaven, well, you know, you can't get much better than heaven, right? I mean, is there a need? Would I not go to heaven? And I guess here's my answer to you, that God gave us his church. God gave us his word, but he gave us the sacrifice of his son, and he gave us his church. And someone who knew that God gave us the church with the sacraments, with the Eucharist, he knew God gave him this, but he turned his back on it anyways, either not being Catholic or leaving the church, leaving the Catholic Church, would endanger his immortal soul to leave the thing that God gave us for salvation. Now, someone like you, though, you're in the point where, well, I don't know if I should be Catholic or not. And I would say to you that life should be more than just about getting to heaven. Like, I'd ask you this, Bill, why do you want to go to heaven?
Well, why?
Yeah.
First time I think anybody's ever asked that question. Want to go and be with the Lord for sure.
Amen.
But Bill,
I appreciate that answer because a lot of people will start on the shallow end and say, because I want to be happy or because I don't want to go to hell. But at the deepest level, you want to go to heaven because you want to be with the Lord. And so for me, what I've seen, what God has given us, the deepest way to be with him is not just to read his word and pray, which is one way to be with him, but also to be with him in the church he gave us, the church he established so that we'd have unity of beliefs, the church that would give us the Eucharist so we can receive Jesus not just as a symbol, but really and truly as his body and blood under the form of bread and wine so the Lord can be with us here. That the Mass, a Catholic Mass, it's really like a taste of heaven here on earth. And when you read, because for me, what really brought me into the Catholic Church is I said, you know, there's all these different churches out there. I want to be like the very, very first Christians. What did they believe? And Bill, when I read them, they didn't say things like, just believe in Jesus or just read the Bible. The very first Christians, the first Christians after the Bible was written, what they said were things like St. Ignatius. He said, follow the bishop as you would Jesus Christ. St. Ignatius, he said, this is in the year 110 AD, that heretics deny the Eucharist is the body and blood of our Savior. So that the church gives us the Eucharist to feed on. It gives us the sacrament of confession. If we sin, if we ever fall away from God, God has given us a means to be reconciled to him, given us these graces, because the spiritual life is hard. I know you said, you know, well, I'm saved, but the Bible, it talks about salvation in past, present, and future. Because in 1 Corinthians 15, St. Paul says we are being saved. And in Romans 13:11, St. Paul says, salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. So salvation is a process. We are saved by the grace of God. We become his adopted children. We are being saved by persevering in faith, but we await salvation in its final, and we need God's grace to get us there. We can't do it on our own. And what's beautiful about the Catholic Church is God has given us this powerful grace, his own life, through things like the Eucharist, through confession, through prayers for one another, asking Christians who've gone before us to pray for us to bring us closer to him and closer to one another. So I would say that when we are looking at what church to belong to, it should be, I want to go to heaven because I want to be close to the Lord. What church did Jesus give us that will bring me closer to him? So what I would like to do, though, is send you a copy of my book, Why We're Catholic, because if you haven't met many Catholics, you might have a lot of questions. So, Bill, if you stay on the line, I will gladly send you a copy of my book, Why We're Catholic. You could read through it, and then you could always call back the show if you have questions about what you found in there. So would that be helpful for you?
Yeah, it would be very helpful, because, I mean, you know, I'm still at a loss, because it's a lot of what you guys talk about as far as I don't even know what a Eucharist is. So,
yeah,
you know,
sure.
We talk about certain things, rosary, and it, I don't got a clue what that is. I listen, But it, you understand, man, it's all new to me.
Absolutely. So Bill, I think it'll be helpful. So stay on the line. We'll get you the book. And the chapters I think that would be helpful for you are like chapters 10 through 18, the middle of the book. And that talks about why we are Catholic, why we have a pope, why we go to Mass, what the Eucharist is, why we go to confession, what we believe about how to be saved, what we believe about how you get to heaven. So we will send. So Bill, stay on the line. We'll send that to you because I think what's helpful is you could read that. You'll get a foundation like, okay, so here's what Catholics believe. And then if you have more questions, call us back and we'll talk to you about that. And then we can kind of move the conversation forward.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Will do.
Thank you, Bill. It was a real pleasure to get to speak with you. 888-318-7884 is our number. The question today, why aren't you Catholic? 888-318-7884. I want to remind you that in July, apparently this is a tradition. It's store-wide summer sale at shop.catholic.com. Everything is 10 to 25% off, in some cases even more than 25% off. You don't need a promo code. You just go there to shop.catholic.com. Mm-hmm. And when you check out, you get all that, you get all those discounts, 10 to 20% off on each thing, including stuff, a whole bunch of stuff from Trent Horn. You know, Trent's the author of a lot of books. Why We're Catholic is there. Mm-hmm. Answering Atheism's there. Yes or no?
Yep, it's they're all there.
Oh, really?
The
What the Saints Never Said is there?
It is.
My newest
and Persuasive Pro-Life.
And Hard Sayings?
They will all be there on the online sale.
Hard Sayings, you need to send a truck to pick it up, though. We'll say.
It was a heftier book. That's why I'm kind of alternating between light and hefty books.
Yeah, that's a pretty good stack there, Trent. And that's not even all of your books. 888-318-7884. Just some lovely conversations today. I just feel so good for a Friday. And it's not just the popsicle they gave me at the last break. It's wonderful to get to talk to folks. If you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't called yet, 888-31-TRUTH is the number. Why Aren't You Catholic? With Trent Horn continues on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Archbishop Charles Chaput of Philadelphia says of Why We're Catholic, clear, practical, simply organized, very readable, and rich in content. It's a pleasure to recommend it. Bishop Thomas Olmsted of Phoenix says, this book is made for the challenges of our times. I highly recommend it. Why We're Catholic is the groundbreaking resource by apologist Trent Horn. That one book you can hand to anyone as a starting point for helping them find their way into, or back to, the practice of the Catholic faith. Plant seeds of faith in the hearts and minds of your non-Catholic friends and family. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic today. You can order your copies of Why We're Catholic by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Broussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
I'm Tom Price.
And I'm Gloria Purvis. Monday, Monsignor Charles Pope.
And we'll talk sacred music with Adrienne Price. Join us Monday for Morning Glory, 7 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Tom Price, Gloria Purvis, sending it back to us. That's big time. Are we big time now, Nick? Nick, the audio man says we are big time. He's in there in the control room with the control room staff. They are no longer called the booth people. They promoted themselves to the control room staff. Very proud of them for speaking up for themselves. and wresting that concession from Catholic Answers. No money came with that, but congratulations to you all on being the control room people. Our question here, why aren't you Catholic? And here to engage in conversation with you about that is Trent Horn. Trent's podcast is Council of Trent, C-O-U-N-S-E-L, of Trent, and you can find out all about it by going to trenthornpodcast.com. We go now to Debbie in Indiana, listening on 95.7 AM. Excuse me, that's FM. Debbie, you're, excuse me, Debbie, I'm having a little trouble here all of a sudden. Why aren't you Catholic, Debbie?
I have a question. I am Catholic, and I asked her if it was okay to talk to you, but can sure. you explain the process of annulment and mm-hmm. finding God's redemptive love in that process, because it is a process.
Yes, it is. So annulments are part of the church's canon law. It's specifically related to the sacrament of matrimony or to marriage. So the principle of annulments is this. Sometimes when a couple goes through a wedding, even though they've completed a wedding and it appears they are married, a condition that is necessary for marriage has not been met. There may be some impediment or something that kept the two from really and truly being married in the eyes of the church. And so it's possible that while they appear to be married, their marriage is actually invalid for some reason. And so the annulment process is an investigatory process. And this is not, it's a process done by a tribunal in a diocese. And it's not like an adversarial process where, because usually people seek annulments when they're having marital difficulties or seeking divorce. And it's not like in legal courts where you've got husband versus wife, and it's not like that. The annulment process in a tribunal is a fact-finding process. It's to understand not how the marriage ended or not what the faults were at the end of the marriage, but at the beginning of the marriage, were all the elements present for there to be a valid marriage? Was there valid form? Was a couple married in the church? Were there any impediments? Had the couple been married before? Were they closely related? Was there a psychological defect? Was someone pressured into being married? They didn't fully consent to it. Lots of different things are factored into that to determine. And if it is determined that one of those conditions is not met, the marriage is then determined or declared to be null, or that it never happened. It's not a divorce, it's a declaration the marriage never took place. So the man and woman are no longer bound to the vows of marriage with one another. So that would be a short summary. I hope that that's helpful. And if you have a follow-up question, I'm happy to engage that.
That was a good, that was good. If you do not choose to seek the annulment, can you still partake in the Eucharist?
Well, I would need a little bit more information about the case that you would be referring to. I'm also curious if this, Debbie, is a question out of curiosity for you, or if it affects you or maybe a family member in a personal way. But if a couple seeks an annulment, mm-hmm. Here's how I would put it. The church always presumes, there's a presumption that a marriage is valid until it is declared otherwise. So even if an annulment process is started, but it's not completed, or there's just an inquiry into getting an annulment, but the couple, no one ever decides to seek an annulment, then the marriage is presumed to be valid unless the church declares that it has been null through the annulment process.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, Debbie. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Why aren't you Catholic is our question of the day. William in North Carolina is listening on EWTN Radio. William, why aren't you Catholic?
Hello. I go to a Pentecostal church. In our church, we have evidence of spiritual gifts, evidence of speaking in other tongues and people getting slain in the spirit. Mm-hmm. And we have altar call for healing and that kind of thing in our church.
Okay.
And I have, of all the Catholics I have known, I have never heard of these things in the Catholic Church. I don't see any spiritual gifts in the Catholic Church like that. Not that kind, anyway.
Right, because William, the Bible talks about many different kinds of spiritual gifts, right? Like such as being a teacher, for example, or prophet, or things like that. Like, so I'm glad you qualified that, because in Paul's letter to the Corinthians and other places, including the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you know, we talk about things like the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the fruit of the Holy Spirit, referring to things like counsel and wisdom, love, joy, peace, patience, and kindness. And I think we see many of those things, both the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the fruits of the Holy Spirit, in the lives of saints and in lives of Catholics now. There's a few things I'd like to reply and ask you some questions about your concern here. Number one, there are Catholics who manifest these particular charisms or gifts you're referring to, such as speaking in tongues or being slain in the Spirit, which actually, the Bible itself, it talks about speaking in tongues in a few verses. I'm not aware of the Bible describing being slain in the Spirit in anywhere. The Bible talks about people falling on their face in the presence of God, but not the modern phenomena of being slain in the Spirit. I don't see that in the Bible at all, actually. However, those kinds of charisms, you do see them in the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. So you can look online, and there are Catholics who testify to having these particular gifts. And the Church says that these kinds of gifts, the Holy Spirit can give them to people. So you can look up Catholic Charismatic Renewal to show there are Catholics who identify as having these particular gifts. And the Church permits it and says, yes, this can be a valid way the Holy Spirit gives gifts to the faithful. However, I don't think it follows that, one, merely showing these gifts shows that you are an authentic church, and two, not having them shows that you're not. William, you identify as Pentecostal. Are you familiar with Oneness Pentecostals?
Yes. They don't believe in the Holy Trinity.
They don't. Do you believe in the Trinity?
Yes, I do.
Okay, but the Oneness Pentecostals, they have a lot of tongues and slain in the Spirit too, right?
Yes, they do.
Right, but the problem is they're not Christians even. They don't even believe in the Trinity. So just because you see these charisms doesn't even mean that the people have, that they're even Christian or they have the correct theology. So these particular charisms, number one, right there, wait a minute, they're not a guarantee that you've got Orthodox faithful Christianity here. And number two, their absence. You know, in my church that I go to every Sunday, people aren't speaking in tongues or being slain in the Spirit. Though I will add as a qualifier, when we look in things like 1 Corinthians 14:14 and other parts of the New Testament, the Bible talks about speaking in a tongue or speaking in actual foreign languages a person may not understand. There's not a lot of biblical evidence that for speaking in tongues in the time of the Bible is the same as now, which is just kind of incomprehensible utterances. Not to say that that's not a gift of the Spirit, but I don't think it's a good idea to say that, oh, if I don't see these things, that's not authentic Christianity. Because I would ask you, William, where does the Bible say a church needs to have these things in all of its services to be, you know, authentic? Like, where does the Bible describes it happening, but does it ever say anywhere every church needs to have this to be authentic? You see where I'm going?
Okay. Well, I know the Apostle Paul said that, I think he was speaking maybe at Corinth, he said, I wish all of you had the gift of speaking in tongues.
Sure, but he also says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, I wish all of you weren't married like I was.
Okay.
Yeah. So I mean, okay. he can. Paul was very. There were lots of gifts. There's lots of gifts that God can give us, but we can't have them all. I mean, it's a gift to be a husband and father, to raise up holy children, and it's a gift to be single, to devote your life to God. But you can't have both at the same time. So I mean, that's why St. Paul talks about in Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 14. He talks about all these different gifts God gives, but not that necessarily everyone's going to have them or will see them in every denomination. And as I showed with the Oneness Pentecostals, even certain gifts, you know, that you're valuing, like tongue, slain in the Spirit, they have those, but they're not even Christian. So I think what should lead us towards saying, is this the right church, is not merely some of the charisms we may see there, but what's their theology? What's their authority? And for me, what attracted me to the Catholic Church is that the authority of the Church through the succession of the bishops and the Pope goes all the way back to the apostles. That it's not just a private interpretation of Scripture, that the Church gave us Scripture, sacred tradition and Scripture were entrusted to the Church Jesus founded through the sacraments, that God gives us gifts through charisms, but also the greatest gift he gave us are the sacraments themselves, like the Eucharist, like confession, confirmation, and things like that. So I would definitely recommend check out our website at catholic.com. And you might also like some of the writings at timstaples.com. So Tim is our director of apologetics, and Tim himself is a former Pentecostal. So he has quite an affinity for that particular branch of Christianity. So check out catholic.com and timstaples.com for more.
Okay, William?
Okay.
Thank you so much. Real pleasure to get to talk with you, William. I just feel so humbled today. I don't know. We just saw so many wonderful callers. I do feel like maybe there are those who listening who it occurs to them that they want to become Catholics, that they want to enter into full communion with the Catholic Church. You can find a local parish. You can see about the RCIA. It's the Rite of Christian Initiation for Adults. It usually takes a great deal of time. It's slow, and you can ask all your questions. There's no obligations. It's not like you join RCIA, and by at the end of it, you better be Catholic.
Right, no, it's a period of inquiry. And I know people who've started the RCIA process, declined to enter into the church the following Easter, and then joined 2 or 3 years later.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Another good website is CatholicsComeHome.org.
Great.
It's a great website geared towards people who are interested in either reverting back to the Catholic faith or become Catholic. And there's great questions, and they can help you find a parish near you. That's CatholicsComeHome.org.
Why aren't you Catholic is our question today. Thank you so much to those who have called willing to answer that question. If you would like to answer that question, we got another segment left. 888-31-TRUTH is the number. We'd probably be able to get you in. We'll be right back with more. Trent Horn, Why Aren't You Catholic? On Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Your number one source for Catholic apologetics and evangelization, Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and I'm here to tell you about a very special promotion we look forward to every year, our annual store-wide summer sale in the online shop at Catholic.com. This spectacular online event includes savings of 10 to 25% and more in some cases on every book, tract, CD, DVD, ebook, and MP3 we carry, including my new book, What the Saints Never Said. With lower prices and a great selection, it's by far the best online Catholic sale of the summer. So log on now and all this month to the shop at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our very special prices. You know it's all good stuff because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
Have you ever been so grief-stricken and so heart-sick that you can't see God? You can't see God in the tragedy. You can't see God in that cross. You can't see God in that sin. Why? You're enveloped in that grief. You're enveloped in fear. And God is out the window. You don't see Him standing right next to you.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Do you enjoy tedious lectures full of facts you'll never use? We didn't think so. That's why we're launching the Council of Trent, Trent Horn's engaging new podcast. Every week, you'll get lively lessons in Catholic teaching, as well as a new conversation roadmap that will help you share your Catholic faith with anyone, anytime, anywhere. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com now to find out how you can subscribe to this exciting new podcast.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Trent Horn is our guest, and we are asking our callers today, why aren't you Catholic? We go now to Christopher in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on 102.7 FM. I believe that's Spirit Catholic Radio. Christopher, you are on with Trent Horn. Why aren't you a Catholic?
Okay, so hopefully I can articulate this because I think I confused the call screener.
That's actually hard to do. She's pretty sharp, so give us a try.
All right, so I was Catholic. I left the church to go into the Eastern Orthodox Church. Mm-hmm. So I'm currently Eastern Orthodox. Now, every so often I think about becoming Catholic again, mm-hmm. but I guess what prevents me really is I don't see a good reason, mainly because in the Orthodox Church we have valid sacraments, even as the Catholics would admit, and I believe even the Catholics have kind of moved away from the idea of proselytizing or trying to convert Orthodox to the Catholic faith. Mm-hmm. So I guess looking at it like I have in the Orthodox Church valid sacraments. I receive the Eucharist, confession. I've got church tradition. I have the history of the church. We have apostolic succession in our priesthood. So I guess I just don't see the purpose in going back, especially with the, I guess what I would call spiritual benefits that I've received from being in Orthodoxy. I miss a lot about the Catholic Church, but I guess I just don't see the compelling reason.
Christopher, why did you leave the Catholic Church in the first place to become Orthodox?
Honest answer, I guess I would consider myself a very traditional person, and the liturgical state of the modern Catholic Church really to me was a big turnoff. I like to say I was an EWTN convert, so I used to watch EWTN and look at the Mass and think, wow, this is so beautiful. And then what I found on the ground, day-to-day parish life in the Catholic Church was so different from what I was reading about in the historical Catholic Church.
It reminds me of a tract I read from a more traditional Catholic talking about, here's the Latin Mass and the Novus Ordo, the New Order Mass, post-Vatican II. And this is someone who's very traditional. So they had a picture of people praying next to an organ, an animated cartoon, like a little drawing. And then on the other side, it was Novus Ordo Mass, and it was this drawing of like people sitting around playing guitar. Uh-huh. And weren't even in pews. But I think that, you know, you're sitting around with the guitar and you're singing hymns that sound like 80s TV show theme songs. Yeah, that can be kind of difficult. I see where you're coming from. But at the same time, I don't think it's a valid reason to go from Catholicism to Orthodoxy. Because interesting, I think you and many other people would sense there are significant differences beyond liturgical between Catholics and Orthodox. And also, what you desire, you can find in the Catholic Church. In many cities, for example, you could find an eparchy and worship at an Eastern Catholic Church. There, it's almost the same liturgy to the divine liturgy you would have at the Eastern Orthodox service to go to a Maronite or a Byzantine rite, or to even go to a Latin rite parish, like one of the ones that celebrates the Tridentine Mass. So I think what you'll have to do is look and say, well, if I have this, you'd have to take an honest look at really like what's, if there's no real difference between Orthodox and Catholic, then there shouldn't be that big of a deal just going back to being Catholic and finding a church with these liturgies. But I would say that there is a big difference. And for me, Christopher, the biggest difference between Catholics and Orthodox, I mean, this is the key big difference that does make a difference, is the authority of the Pope, and it's not simply an academic matter. It's funny, I was actually writing a script today about on a video called Why We Need a Pope. And if you think like the most successful organizations in the world, successful franchises, governments, civil services, militaries, they always have a branching hierarchy with one leader on top. There was a scene in the Office where Oscar makes a joke about how Michael and Jim are, and I apologize, Christopher, to make a pop culture segue here, where he's, you know, Michael and Jim are co-managers, and Oscar says, what country doesn't have two presidents? What would Catholicism be without the popes? And so we see that a single leader makes sense to have organizational structure and clarity and uniformity. And so for me, Christopher, the reason I believe that Christ Church has that is that if we go back to the Bible, we see Peter has that unique authority over the other apostles that even non-Catholic scholars will admit to, and that authority in his successors in the Bishop of Rome was identified very early in the history of the church. And it's a great benefit, actually, to the church to have the Pope, who has that authority, not that he's some kind of tyrant that can just wield autocratic power, but that you have one person to serve as the pastor over the whole church, just like in Israel, you had one chief steward over the whole kingdom of God who served under the king. So the analogy would be that in the ancient Israel, God is the king, a chief steward is, you know, sorry, there's the, you know, the king of the kingdom, he has a chief steward, and then the subjects. Jesus is our king. He's the king of the kingdom of God here on earth. And he's given us a chief steward and the successor of St. Peter. And that gives us unity. Like, for one point I think I bring up, I don't want to ramble on too long here. I'm sure to get your thoughts. I find it troubling that since the Seventh Ecumenical Council, the Eastern Orthodox cannot call an ecumenical council of all Eastern Orthodox bishops. There never has been one. And no one even thinks there ever could be one in the future. That without that single voice from someone having special authority from St. Peter, you lose that unity. And what I've seen in the Orthodox when I was looking at that time to maybe convert leads to kind of a fuzziness in theology and other things like that. So I think that God gave us a great gift in the Catholic Church with the Pope to provide that unity and that structure for believers. And so that gives us the fullness of the church given here to be able to rejoice in. So that's what I think makes a big deal to me, and that might be what I would share with you, along with, I think the church has liturgy that you would find to be very uplifting. So I know I threw a lot out at you. I don't know, what do you think of all that?
Oh, no, I appreciate that. Perhaps I should have clarified. I mean, the liturgy was like the straw that broke the camel's back, and then many more reasons for converting. I agree that, yes, the ecumenical councils of the earliest church consistently rank Rome first among the churches. That's obvious. There's no question about it. Mm-hmm. But there is still a unity within Orthodoxy, and they have preserved tradition for 2,000 years, and one would say without having a unified head. And yet without that, we have still maintained the valid sacraments, mm-hmm. the tradition of the apostles, apostolic succession. Even yet without a pope, we have maintained those traditions.
That's not necessarily, but Christopher, that's not necessarily a virtue, though, to be, because one could also say, in spite of this, that I certainly, obviously, the church does not deny that there has been a valid succession, there are valid orders and valid sacraments within the Eastern Orthodox Church. But I would say that the faith that has been given to us, the Catholic or universal faith of the church, includes much, much more than that. Those are the very basics. But that there are also elements of teaching and understanding of doctrine that still need to be understood, lived out, to be defined and declared, that you don't see as much. You can't really have that within the Eastern Orthodox like you can in the Catholic Church through things like the declarations from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, through promulgations, both ex cathedra statements from the Pope, and encyclicals, apostolic bulls, and things like that, to be able to provide this fullness, if you will, of understanding what we ought to believe. So I think that you've raised some good points here. But I also think that there's a lot more for you to be able to consider, and not to look at it as, have the Eastern Orthodox been able to maintain the sacraments with things that are so minimal? Where is the maximal that God has given us, and is it in the Catholic Church? So I hope you'll call back, especially maybe during an open forum where we can go into the topic a little more in depth. A good book I would recommend you would be Rome and the Eastern Churches, by Aidan Nichols. He's a Dominican, I think he's a priest. Aidan Nichols, Rome and the Eastern Churches. That may help sort out some of the differences there that you're currently working on. And I'll pray for you through your discernment, and hope our listeners will pray for you as well.
Thank you, Christopher.
God bless. Thank you.
All right. Plus, I mean, you got to have a pope, because who's going to live in the Vatican? I mean, we got the whole thing.
Is that
illogical, or does it you don't find that dispositive?
It is a colorful fallacy that you've given us. So that there must
the whole thing. We don't want to waste it.
That's true. If we have the Vatican, you know, who's going to live there? That's like the argument well, if Jesus isn't, you know, if Jesus never existed, then who's his father or something like that. See, now I forget.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Now
yeah.
I forget.
Yeah. So it's right. We're arguing from.
If atheism is true, then who is Jesus's dad?
But still, it would be a bummer to have the whole Vatican and no Pope.
Right.
I mean, you got to have somebody who.
And I think actually a good resource here, I think it's available online from our previous conference. My colleague Carlo Broussard he gave a talk on the papacy and the unity it provides to Christians.
Yeah.
The keys to unity found in the papacy. So I'd recommend if you want to go to our last year's conference and look up that talk by Carlo Broussard. Carlo Broussard, yeah. Unity of the Church, the Papacy, I highly recommend.
Also, when you have the Pope over here, it can help with local persecution of the church because the local bishop has, and this has been the case with communism and others, where the local bishops were under tremendous pressure. But that doesn't change the teaching of the church because you still have the Pope in Rome,
right.
Away from that.
Yeah.
Trent Horn, it's always a great pleasure. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you for hosting, Cy.
Jesus Christ is the light of the nations, and we'll see you next time on Catholic Answers Live.